Kottak.
Mr. James Kottak in the house.
Yes. Yay. Scorpions, baby.
Thank you so much.
Man.
How are you, James?
I'm doing great. I just wanted to say, man, dude, Alvin just kicks ass on drums, man. The whole band sounded great. You sounded good. Willie was playing bass. Open it up for yourself. Jesus.
It's hard work.
Alvin's got that thing. But you know what? I want to say it was an honor. I knew Soko very well.
Oh, you did?
I knew Soko, yeah, of course.
Wow.
I met Soko through Krieger, and Soko was just, Soko taught me the fatback. Nobody knows what the fatback is.
Roz, did you?
Alvin that? Knows what the fatback is.
Soko taught him the fatback.
Yeah, man, Soko. I know. Soko was like, he was just a wealth of information. So RIP, dude. I know he's watching, listening.
Yes. So, James Kottak, Mr. Kingdom Come, what was it? Wild Horses? Wild Horses.
Ronnie Montrose.
Unbelievable, man.
Yeah, I know. I'm so
Scorpions
fortunate.
For 17 years.
I know. I'm old, man.
This seems like it was a couple of years ago.
I remember one of my very first Southern California performances with Scorpions. You came.
Right,
you were there. We were down in like
because Motley Crue opened up and they had stole my drummer Randy Castillo.
Randy was
for
that's
the
right.
Second
Randy
time around.
Oh my God!
First time Lita stole Randy, and then you know
I think
Nikki Sixx offered him $1 million, and I was like, I couldn't go. Well, dude, that's not enough money. You
know? It's all
don't
about
take that gig.
It's all about the rite of passage.
That doesn't sound like Nikki.
No.
No, but it's just an honor to have you here.
Well, thank you. You know, it was great to come down and see a great band. You got a great vibe. I don't know what the deal is with Earl. I think I don't know who you are.
Like a middle reliever.
I owe him money.
But Willie Basse, we go back so like 50,000. I think I met you in 1947, you know, and you're just always doing something rock and roll and something cool and keeping it alive, man. There's so many tales from the Sunset Strip that you could tell. It's just as awesome,
I think. It's funny. Did you see the picture of Mitch Perry on the golf cart saying he was going to do a Mick Brown impersonation?
No, I didn't see that.
It's on Facebook. It's hilarious, man. But I think the first time we played together was you, myself, and Mitch Perry out at the pier.
Oh, my God, down in Huntington Beach.
Yeah.
I came down in my Cadillac. I used to have a 65
Cadillac.
And it was just enough room. I had a Ludwig Vistalite set that just lived in the trunk. So no matter what, go, hey, dude, you want to play? Sure, I'll be right there. Pull up my Cadillac, empty that bastard. And I had to sell that car, man, because it just needed too much maintenance. Uh-oh.
Well, we got a secret caller.
Somebody's calling.
So much fun. So much fun.
Awesome.
But tell us a little bit more about you've got a solo album, a solo band, Kottak Attack?
Right. I had originally had a band called Crunk. And then
Love
that
Crunk.
But that term became synonymous with a lot of the rap groups. So the record label says, you know what, change it to Kottak. I'm like going, that's my last name. I don't want to do that. But on the advice of Alvin and Mick Fleetwood, always put your name in the title so you can't get fired. Thank you, Alvin.
What a concept.
Yeah. And, you know, I've got 4 albums out now. And
really?
Yeah. And we toured Europe last spring.
Who's in the band?
Well, of course, moi. I sing and play guitar, though, in the band.
Cool.
And I suck on guitar, but, man, I look great. And
you're writing some pretty cool songs, too.
It's kind of like Cheap Trick meets Green Day on a bad day, and it's fun. It's like my passion project. I work with Tommy Hendrickson, who's the guitarist for Alice Cooper, and he's produced so many albums. And he produced it and co-wrote it with me, and I'm very proud of it. So the 4 albums are out. Just go to Amazon, iTunes, et cetera, and all that. And it's fun. It's raw. If you're having a bad day, your dog died, put on a Kottak album, and you'll be smiling in 10 minutes
or
5.
I love it.
Yeah, and it's great. And, you know, it was also a challenge for me to sing and play guitar and be out front because I've been a drummer forever, so I need a new
challenge. You're a great front man.
Well, thank you.
Now, tell us about some of the film footage on the Scorpions drum solo, because there was this one where you looked like you were flying and you turned into an airplane, and then, boom, you woke up and you were walking through the desert.
Well, you know, one thing, for those who don't know.
Classic James Kottak, though. You know, like, boom, he's in the desert.
I have a drum solo, and the title of the solo is called Kottak Attack. Anyway, I've been doing it for years, and I go, you know what? Who wants to hear another drum solo? Let's add the visual. So we got these monster media screens at our show. So I put together this fantasy film, which there's all the Scorpion album covers. And if you recall, the album covers are like really artistic.
Yeah,
like
Love
in the back,
First
Love
Steam,
Drive, Love It for Steam,
blah, blah, blah.
So those album, those are just stills. So I said, I went to this dude out in Phoenix, and this guy, Paul, and I said, look, I want to make the album covers come to life. So I flew out there and we filmed for a day for like 50 hours straight, and we made the album covers come live, and I present them, and it's like a celebration of the Scorpions albums with a drum solo.
Cool.
And is it visually, and it's wonderful. So just go on YouTube and Kottak Attack.
How did you come up with the thing where you turn into the airplane?
I just kind of said I want to do something really fantasy, like cartoon, like Wile E. Coyote, that kind of a thing. And it worked, man. And they came up with a script, and they had me making out with all these chicks. I'm like, going, I'm in. So, you know, go check it out on YouTube, and then come see Scorpions live. And,
it was incredible.
Well, thank you.
So, what's up now? I hear you guys are going down south a little bit there in September.
Is that what they call these days?
The fall? Down south?
We're going to South America September, and then we do have like a month in France in November.
Wow.
And a bunch of dates, like four shows in Ukraine,
incredible.
One in Poland. And
you hear you guys are like the Beatles in Russia.
It's really true. But the most
you need
wonderful
a bodyguard
thing,
to go to the bathroom. What's up?
Well,
with
you're
that,
well, you need somebody to hold it.
Oh.
But the thing is, you know, when the Scorpions said, it's farewell tour, that doesn't mean the band's breaking up. That just means we're not going to tour at this level. We have one more year of touring like this, and it's just a celebration, and we're having a party everywhere in the world.
It's not a grand farewell. It's just sort of like...
It's a farewell.
Really?
Because the Scorpions want to go on top, which is great. And I just want to say I'm so thankful and fortunate and lucky to be playing rock and roll for 35 years, and that the fact that I'm still 26 years old is amazing.
You look great.
Yep, I love it.
Thank you.
Now, you've got a book coming out or a movie or what's
going
on?
Well, I met a film director named Stephanie Smith, and
she... We love Stephanie Smith.
She's awesome. And
Yeah.
The best part is she's always walking around topless. That's... anyway, she worked on this movie, independent movie, called The Wanteds. And The Wanteds is about a one-man band who goes across the country, and he's rediscovering his past. And it starts off Spinal Tap and ends up Shakespeare. And I watched this movie, The Wanteds, and just fell in love with it.
Cool.
And I ended up, like, it's not your typical rock and roll movie. I ended up, you know, I'm crying my eyes out on the plane going, "Whoa!" Anyway, I've been approached so many times to say, hey, you want to do a drum video? You want to do this video? You want to do that? And I'm like, oh, no, I don't think we need another drum instructional video.
But I will warn you, James.
And Stephanie
Smith. And Stephanie, brilliant filmmaker.
Great film director. She also, with The Wanted, she actually, out of 8 festivals over the last year, won 8 awards,
awesome.
Including Best Film, Best Director, Best This. I mean, we went to Cannes Film Festival, and she just signed a deal with a major movie company that I can't say the name of. But congratulations, Stephanie.
Yes, come on, give it to Stephanie.
And tell us the name of your movie again, because I think we missed it.
Mine's probably going to be James Kottak Rock and Roll Forever, because I happen to have a big tattoo on my back, and I'm committed to that. And it's more,
slightly,
it's not so much the
committed
story of like, oh yeah, I play rock and roll drums and this. It's more of a life story, and you know, and it's a survival story, because it's really easy to get in rock and roll, but it's very hard to stay in rock and roll and maintain it. And it could be music business in general. It'll eat you up and spit you out. Here you got guys like Alvin over here, and these guys, and man, they're just still survivors. You know, Willie Basse, what are you, 117 now? Look, he's
I'm still doing this.
I'm still 19. I'm 26.
I see my daughter, she's 28. I'm amazed. It's like, where did that, you know, she's a woman.
I'm 26,
I'm still 19.
Dude. I stopped there, and you know, if I ever do get to 50, I'm going to start counting backwards, you know?
Well, we really love you, man.
Oh, thank you,
thank
Willie
you for
Basse.
Coming by. And,
I appreciate it.
We look forward to doing more and seeing
Heck
you out there. And maybe we can get you to Skype in when you're in
Absolutely.
Some bullpen in South America or soccer stadium.
I'd like to say, though, that I think it's really great. Your foundation to the Feed America thing is so great.
FeedAmerica.org.
You always have a great program. Yeah, and that's one thing I really love about you, Willie Basse. You always have something up your sleeve. But it's not just like, I'm a rock star and I'm just going to rape and pillage. No, you have good causes, and it's for, you know, all in the name of rock and roll.
And
think that's awesome.
And then we rape and pillage.
Hey.
No. We're,
thank you guys
we're
very much.
We're teaming up with Vice Salas and vicesalas.com. And we're going to feed people because we've got a new product out that gives everyone more nutrition and more vitamins than a 6,000-calorie meal in two shakes, in one shake every day. So, you know, we could do this for $1 a day, $2 a day, you know, and we can feed people. So we're real excited about that.
You know, you guys have been talking about great records and stuff. You know, James Kottak. James played on a great record called Breakaway by this friend of mine named Willie Basse. That's a single. It's a great song.
Breakaway.
Speaking and talking about Fatback, that's where, I mean, when he said he learned that shit from Soko, he's got that stuff right on that record, man. I mean, it's proof right there is in the pudding on Breakaway.
Thank you.
Get Breakaway and check it out, folks.
All right. Thank you. Thank you.
Willie Basse, thank you very much for having
Thanks
me.
Thanks for stopping
by. I really enjoyed it. Thank you, Earl.
James Kottak,
awesome.
Great drummer.
I'll call from anywhere on the corner of the world. And Dunkerson, my friend.
We got proof now. We love James Kottak.
Thank you, James.
So, Mr. Scott Page.
Oh, dude, I get to talk too now.
Yeah.
Oh, geez, I get to talk too. How about that? Well, I'm tweeting.
Scott Page.
Dude, just so you know, I'm tweeting and sending pictures out on your behalf here, dude.
Cool.
Yeah, it's good.
So
good.
Tell us a little bit about, were you with Supertramp or what? What's the story?
Supertramp was early before Pink Floyd. Yes, I was with Supertramp.
So you know Ken, you know Ken Scott then?
Yes, absolutely.
The Ken Scott.
The.
Oh, wow.
And actually, it's actually how I ended up meeting Dave Gilmour was, we were doing a Supertramp album, and Dave came in and put a solo on it. And then we hung out, and that night I had a gig over at Josephina's. Remember Josephina's, right?
Wow.
Because we used to have the house band there, you know, with Mike Finnegan.
Right,
And Jeff Baxter and all those guys we played there. So I invited Gilmour over that night to, you know, come over and hang out with us. We came over that night. And then I told him about this gig that I was putting on this thing called The First Dance. I was doing it at the Guitar Center, which had actually Jeff Beccaro, my old buddy, was going to be playing with us next week. And we had an all-star band with some of the guys from Supertramp, all the Tower Power Horn guys, and the gospel choir.
Where the hell was
And everybody, the guys from Supertramp, everybody came and played. And so Gilmour came to that thing because Jeff was working actually on the Pink Floyd record.
Uh-huh.
And,
I didn't know.
Yeah, Jeff played on Momentary Lapse of Reason.
Unbelievable.
Yeah, and so Jeff was in the studio with Gilmour, and he says, "Hey, man, I got a split because I'm going to go do Page's thing." He says, "Why don't you come along?" So he came along that night. Saw the gig, next day he called me up and said, "Hey, dude, you want to come play a solo on the record?" So I went over and I put a solo on that tune. That was the beginning.
The first Pink Floyd experience?
It was Dogs, and I put the solo on Dogs of War.
Oh.
He called me up the other day, a couple days later, and said, "Hey, do you want to come out and do the tour with us?" And I actually almost turned it down, which was kind of silly. Because I was in the middle of a couple projects and stuff, but then I said, okay, well, and the next thing I know, I'm in Toronto in this airplane hangar. And we're rehearsing at the airport. And it was wild because we had the whole giant airplane hangar. You can imagine the size of Floyd and the magnitude of everything there. And they had the back doors opened up, and here we're playing. And, you know, like, spaceships are flying around in the room and all these lights. And big 747s are going right by the outside door. It was trippy. Yeah, those are great times.
Only
Pink
Floyd, man.
Oh, yeah, I mean, that's one thing about Floyd is they definitely know how to do it grand.
Yeah, but I love the barge story that we were talking about the other day.
Yeah, Gilmour's studio.
Yeah. He's got a Neve console on a barge somewhere in the UK.
On the Thames.
And it's just incredible.
Yeah, it's an amazing. It's actually it's like a houseboat, and it actually I believe it belonged to Charlie Chaplin's manager. Mm. And they told me some stories where they used to have a 110-piece orchestra sit on the top of the thing and play concerts to the Thames.
Amazing.
Yeah, it's a beautiful. It's amazing. Leaded glass. Beautiful. Gorgeous place. Cool place to have a studio.
So what's in store for Scott Page these days? I mean, you're going to be working with me on the FeedAmerica-Now.org project.
Absolutely. Yep, definitely.
Our goal is to feed 2 million people before Christmas.
So got to do that.
Tell us more about Scott and what projects, what you got coming up.
Well, you know, I've been pretty much a tech guy a lot for the last sort of 20 years. After I left Floyd in 92, I'd started a business. And
you said you have a lot of footage in the can or something.
Oh,
right?
Yeah. So, yeah, got a lot of that. I've shot about 150 hours on Floyd, and I've been archiving for the last 50 years.
Wow.
And I've actually, it's interesting because I've just been putting it in this spot. I've never looked at it. So what I'm doing now is I'm actually bringing it out, and I'm going to take my audience on the ride to see all these bands from when I was playing.
So it'll be somewhat interactive then.
Yeah, because what I'm doing is I'm doing a little different because I've got so much footage. I just put the footage up on my computer, and as I'm watching it, when I see something good, I whip out my camera and I go, check this out. Boom. And I shoot the screen.
How cool.
And I start talking about the moment because I hadn't seen it either.
Very cool.
25 years when I pulled this stuff out.
Wow.
So it's actually been a lot of fun to see stories because, I mean, I had one that I came up the other day. It was Rick Wright's birthday, and I think we were in Italy. I believe it was Italy, and they had this big ceremony. It was like 200 people, all the people there, and they had all these giant cakes and all this stuff, and the guy's giving them the, you know, like the key to the city to, you know, whatever they do in Italy in that sense. And Rick had this big giant bottle of champagne, and I was documenting because I was a fanatic, just filming. So I'm sitting there looking
through the that vision.
Yeah, I'm sitting there looking through the lens, and I'm going, wow, okay. And all of a sudden, I see the hands of the guys sliding underneath the cakes, right?
Oh, no.
Man, the biggest food fight you've ever seen in your life. And the poor little lady that actually, she was the pastry chef for the country, whatever it was, about 80 years old, built all these beautiful cakes. It was stacked up real high, turns into a massive food fight.
Oh.
And the next thing I'm shooting this thing, and things are hanging. Rick's flying champagne around like crazy. And the next thing, Gilmore sees me, and he starts chasing me with cake.
Oh.
And I got the camera in my hand, and he goes, right on my head, and you can actually see the piece of cake go right in front of the lens, and then he just puts a big piece of stuff right in the lens. But anyway, I got a ton of stories and a bunch of stuff that's been captured that's really fun, so I think it'll be very interesting for
very
people to
cool.
see. Different kind of strategy. Yep.
Wow.
Yep. Big
so question. You're an innovator with the internet, and you know a lot about marketing and what did you say, content marketing?
Yeah,
right?
I actually I've been a tech guy. Since it's funny because Gilmore used to kind of laugh at me because I'd be reading business books and then when I started my business and I was actually one of the early guys in the whole multimedia side of things. I think one of the kind of things that I'm pretty proud of was I'm in a book with a lot of heavyweight people, 50 pioneers of multimedia. So
wow.
I was one of those guys that started out early in the day doing all the CD-ROM and that's been my first CD-ROM in 89.
Unbelievable.
Which was like early days hanging out with in the cyberpunk scene.
Yeah.
And it was myself and then Todd Rundgren was another guy that was in the thing and then also, what's his name? Blinded me with science.
Thomas Dolby.
Yeah. He was another one. So it was like our little group were kind of the early days of that stuff. So I've been a tech guy for quite a few years and recently been really focusing on kind of the whole idea of content marketing, and I'm actually working on finishing a book called Quit Your Day Job and Get Back to the Music.
Cool.
Because this
is
the greatest time in history for the independent artist.
I love it.
The problem is the independent artists do not know how to build audience and create wealth off the audience, off their product.
And what were you saying if you had 1,000 people?
Yeah,
it's
based on a concept. I can't remember what it was. When I read this, it made a lot of sense. It's based on what they call 1,000 true fans.
Mm-hmm.
And the idea is that if you can, a true fan is defined as someone that will buy something for you $100 a year.
Right.
So if you have 1,000 true fans, it's $100,000 in revenue.
What a concept.
Right. So the model is different through the new world of content marketing is where you give away most of your content,
right.
You keep a little bit, but the idea is it's how to build a relationship with that fan base because that's the fan base that you're going to do. Most artists say, yeah, I've kind of got a list and I tweet and I do this stuff, but they don't really understand what it takes to build a relationship with that fan and then move them into a way that they can monetize that relationship. It's happening all over the internet in other businesses, same model, same system, same platform, same way of putting it together. It's just they have to learn. So I've actually been taking and studying with all these guys like Chris Brogan. And I mean, studying, I don't live with them, but I mean, just following them. Chris Brogan and Brian Clark. And there's actually a site called Copyblogger, copyblogger.com. Anybody wants to learn how to build relationships, how to make it happen, Copyblogger is my favorite site on the internet right
now
because they just give knowledge and they train and they teach. But anyway, so the idea is we're now putting this together to say, wake up, musician. It's time to go make some money because it's content marketing. You get up every day and you make content, so you've already got the hard part figured out. Now you just need to learn how to build a relationship and then monetize that relationship.
Wow. Take that to the bank, ladies
Come
and gentlemen.
Come on, baby.
Mr. Scott Page.
Yay.
And do you have a .com? Or
I'm actually just getting ready to put my little .com. I'm cool. In the middle. It'll be IamScottPage.com. It's my Twitter handle, too. IamScottPage.
Cool.
So, yes, anybody, please come hang out. Tell us stories. I've been tweeting it out to folks and putting stuff on Instagram and just starting to come out in the world myself with all this.
Incredible.
I gotta basically practice what I preach, right? Eat my own dog food.
Absolutely.
So we want to thank you for stopping by, man.
And I want to thank
you. Saxophone.
Oh, thank you, man.
Awesome.
And I want to thank you for letting me play with this killer band.
It's your band,
it's
man.
It's always a killer band. Alvin Taylor.
Yeah, Reggie will be back next week. Reggie McBride.
Oh, yeah. This is serious fun. Big fun.
Yeah, yeah.
All right. Well, thank you very much. And thanks for being so funny, dude.
I want to give a shout out to TwinTalkCast.com. That's our network that we're on. And if you want to hear the show, just go to TwinTalkCast.com. Download the Live 365 app and search for Willie Basse, Twin Talk. All right, so we're signing off, Mr. Earl Skako.
Another show down the hatch, Willie. You're doing 25 jobs, one person. You're the roadie, you're the star.
You gotta find a wiring guy, you know?
I've never seen a guy open for himself.
I love it.
I mean, I've seen a lot of things in stand-up. I've never seen Jerry Seinfeld go out, do a warm-up set, and then Jerry Seinfeld come back out.
Well, I have to say I love it.
You're amazing. You're the hardest working guy I've ever met in my life.
Thank you.
No, thank you. The musicianship on this show is better than anything on any TV show I've seen.
Is that good for a turkey sandwich?
Here? Well, a turkey sandwich is about $20, so it better be.
We want to thank Mark Cantor. Ladies and gentlemen.
Yes.
Cantor's Deli.
The boss.
World famous Kibitz Room.
World famous Kibitz.
And we want to give a shout out to Visalis.com.
Yeah,
yes.
Dude, that's the place. If you want to get fit, man, Visalis.
Visalis.
You've got to check this out. 180,000 people taking the challenge every month, getting healthy, getting fit.
90-day challenge.
Awesome. It's 90 days. And the good part about it is you save money doing it because it's a meal replacement, right? And it's only $2 a meal. So $4 a day for lunch and breakfast, that's cheaper than eating. And on top of it, if you get three friends to take the challenge with it, you get yours for free.
Tell us about that BMW gig.
Well, that's because they have a whole business aspect to it, too, for people to basically turn the challenge into a business that they can make happen. So anyway, it's a long story. But most important, people need to get healthy. We need to feed people, get them healthy, and those folks are doing it right.
Everybody should be able to eat.
That's right. That's my spiel.
Goodbye. I thought you guys were talking about Sea Alice. I take that. That's better than any meal replacement.
FeedAmerica-now.org. We want to thank our makeup department, Sharon Simon.
Oh, Sharon deserves a gold
Sharon
medal.
Sharon Simon.
Come on, give Sharon more than that.
Roz Richardson. We got Delia in the house. And we're signing off. Thank you guys for tuning in. We'll see you soon. Tales from the Sunset Strip.
Yeah. Willie Basse.
Thank you.